saw his mother standing there beside the disciple he loved, he said to her, "Dear woman, here is your son." And he said to this disciple, "Here is your mother." And from then on, this disciple took her into his home. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Though your translation may be different, you should see the basic fundamental gist of what I just read. Amen.
Amen.
From that text, I want to talk to you from the subject, make arrangements for family. Make arrangements for family. Making arrangements for family. Amen. This is a very practical message, and I hope that you hear me. Don't tune me out, because we're not super spiritual today, but we're on a practical level with regards to the Word of God, and all of God's Word is practical. Has a practical application. But today I want to talk about making arrangements for family. Amen. Let's pray, if you will. Pray with me. Lord God, we thank you for the privilege of worship. You've been good to us. We don't deserve this. You've blessed us. Help us now to take full advantage of the privileges you have given us today. Now, we are grateful for what we've already received from your hand. Blessings of life and activity of our limbs, portions of health and strength. We are grateful for that. We're grateful for worship already that's taking place through these young people, through these children, and through our officers and leaders, and through every individual who is engaged. We thank you. We ask now that you take us to another level of worship as we worship in your word, that you would use us to preach the word, that you would have your people to hear, that you would help us to do it with accuracy, with boldness, and with passion. We pray, O God, that you let the words of my mouth and the meditation of all of our hearts be acceptable in your sight. Lord, you have strengthened our Redeemer. In Jesus' name we pray, and every soul say, amen, amen, amen. And make arrangements for family. Amen. One of the things that we have come to realize and understand, especially among people in our community, especially among people in our associations, find that oftentimes people neglect to make arrangements, to make provisions for family. Amen. Somebody ought to say amen. And Jesus as our model for life. Jesus as our model for life helps us to understand what we are to do and be as people of God. We can look at Jesus and see how we are to respond and how we are to act and engage in the world and with one another by what Jesus did. Amen? Now let's not delude ourselves into thinking that Jesus is the Son of God, He's divine, I can't do what He did. Yes, you can. Amen. You can't die for our sins. Because you died, we died for our own sins. But Jesus' life and what he did are things that you and I can do as it relates to living the spirit-filled and spirit-led life. I want to have a couple of witnesses in here that what Jesus did, you can do. He's our model. Because of those of us who have the Holy Spirit living on the inside of us have the same power available to us to live the victorious Christian life. I knew I wasn't going to get a lot of help today. But I'm telling you the truth as it relates to Jesus' example and his model for us in living the Christian life. But Jesus shows us that in spite of the trials and the tribulations, the difficulty and the trouble he was facing, in spite of all that he went through, he was still able to do some things that some of us have a problem with doing, even when there's nothing wrong with us. Are y'all praying with me? Jesus made arrangements for his family. Are y'all gonna pray with me? He made arrangements for family. And I bring it up because Jesus didn't have an ideal situation when he had to handle his business for his family. He was going through trouble and difficulty, yet he made arrangements. Y'all know the story. The Bible helps us and it picks up in this portion of the Gospel of John where Jesus on Thursday night institutes the Lord's Supper with his disciples. And in the upper room with his disciples, with the 12, he institutes the Lord's Supper. The Bible says that he begins to talk to them about what was going to happen in the immediate future so that they would be ready to respond in the appropriate manner to the challenges that lie ahead. And he began telling them, he began talking to them, and the Bible says that he starts telling them about what Judas is up to, been up to, that Judas is going to betray him. He didn't call him by name, but he said, one of y'all that's in this room with me is going to betray me, is going to sell me out. I wish I had a witness. And he began talking about that. He began sharing that he says that don't be too hard on him, because all of y'all are going to leave me. You're going to desert me. So don't be casting stones and disparities at your brother, because all of y'all are subject to do the same thing. Are you praying with me? Then Peter said, Lord, I don't know what the rest of these clowns going to do, but I ain't going to never leave you. I ain't going to never forsake you. Jesus said, before the rooster crows, you're going to deny me 3 times. And y'all know how it went down. The Bible says that Jesus got sold out, and they arrested him in Gethsemane. The Bible says as he was praying to the Father, he kept his inner circle, Peter, James, and John, and told them, look, I know y'all can't do nothing, but just keep your eyes open. Can you do that? I wish I had a witness. And the Bible says that they fell asleep while he was talking to the Father. Then Judas shows up with the rabble. He shows up with the soldiers and betrays Jesus with a kiss. Helps us to understand everybody kissing on you don't mean good for you. Are y'all playing with me? Y'all be somebody to be able to say amen. And so the Bible says that they marched him from judgment hall to judgment hall. Brought him to Caiaphas and brought him to the high priest and marched him to Scripture says that they gave him lashes with a whip that tore the meat from his body. Then the soldiers began to mock him and hit him across the face and beat him so bad that you couldn't even know who he was by looking at him. The scripture says they took a crown as they were mocking him and made it out of thorns and pressed it on his head till the blood ran down his face. And Jesus endured all of that, and if that weren't bad, Jews, if he were to persecute him. And the scripture says, in order to please the Jews, he sentenced him to die on the cross. That wasn't bad enough. They made him carry his own cross up Golgotha's hill, the hill that looked like a skull. And the scripture says that because he had been wounded and beaten so badly, he was unable to carry his cross. And carried this cross for Jesus. I wish I had a witness in here. And the scripture says that when they got to the hill, they laid him down on that cross. And they nailed his hands and nailed his feet to the cross. Then about knowing. The Bible said with all that was going on, Scripture says he was beaten so badly he probably could hardly see. But while he was hanging there on the cross, he looked down and there was his mother. There was his auntie. I wish I had a witness. There was the mother of Cephas. I wish I had a witness. And then the Scripture says that Mary Magdalene, his friend, was there. And the disciple John, who he loved. Jesus found his family. Found his mother and said, "Mother, here is your son." Pointing to John, not pointing, but referring to John, the disciple. And he said, "Son, here is your mother." Jesus, while he was dying on the cross, found a way to make arrangements for his family. That's all I'm trying to say. He made arrangements for his family. Yeah, even though he was dying on the cross for our sins, the Bible says he looked down and he saw his family. And all I'm trying to say, first thing is, we need to see our family. Amen. Are y'all praying with me? We need to be able to see them. Even though life has dealt us a bad hand, you still have an obligation and a responsibility to make arrangements for your family. Are y'all going to pray with me? If I was a preacher, I'd tell you about all of the things that we can do to take care of our family. But look what Jesus did. Jesus, who was the eldest son of his mother, whose responsibility it was in the first century to take care of his mother. I wish I had somebody witnessing it. He made arrangements for his mother by putting her in the hands of his disciple, John the Beloved. And then telling that disciple to take care of my mother. And it helps me to understand that he sees his family even though he's going through hard times. And the problem with many of us is we have problems seeing our family when we are having difficult moments. You still need to see your family. I don't care if you are going through a divorce. You still need to see your family. I don't care if you are, your heart has been broken. You still need to see your family. I don't care if you just got out of jail. Jesus just came out of jail. He just, I wish I had a witness. He's dying on the cross with his hands and his feet nailed, but he found a way to take care of his family. Y'all don't get what I'm saying. Because we have all kinds of excuses why we can't see our family. Pastor, you don't understand. I'm going through a hard time now. But baby, I don't care if you're going through a hard time. Y'all don't hear me. I call people all the time and say, "Listen, you need to come to church. You need to come to church. You need the church. You need the church. You need the word. You need prayer. You need the Bible. You need study. You need it." But Pastor, you don't understand. I'm going through some stuff. Life has dealt me a bad hand. Baby, I know he's dealt you a bad hand. That's why you need to be in church. I don't care what your problem is. It ain't bigger than dying on the cross. I wish I had a witness in here. It ain't bigger than suffering for folks. For your family. Are you praying with me? Yeah. He says, behold. And the word behold in the text is the same word that comes from the word family that we get binoculars from.
Alright.
You need to take the binoculars of your life and focus it not on yourself, because some of us find it hard to see family because we become so selfish and self-absorbed by what we're going through. We don't care about nobody else.
All
right. I wish I had a witness.
That's why
mothers and fathers can make decisions that they make. As it relates to their relationship and their home, without considering how it's going to affect the children that you have brought in the world. It's because you are so self-absorbed. I said it, yes sir. Self-absorbed with your own situation that you can't stop to see your family. I don't care what you're going through. It ain't dying on the cross. Somebody ought to help me in here. see up close the needs of our families and put our families first. Are y'all praying with me? Amen, amen, amen. Because oftentimes what we're going through is not because somebody did something to us. It's because we did something that created a problem in our lives. Somebody ought to be able to say amen. I can if nobody else can. Most of my trouble came because of bad decisions on my own part. I wish I had a witness. Yeah, but the Bible says Jesus was dying not for himself or his sin, but he was dying for our sin. But he still saw his family. Not only did he see his family, he provided for his family. Don't just look at them, look out for them. Amen, amen. If this sermon ain't comfortable, that's good. Let's make some changes. Are y'all gonna pray with me? Amen. Don't just see them, look out for them. If I could just help us to understand that just because you died doesn't mean that you don't have a responsibility to your family. Jesus was dying on the cross. Because some of us say, well, when I die, I don't make no difference what happened. They can do whatever they want then. No. Your responsibility ain't over because you dead. You need to provide for your family even in death. I got a lot of amens. Let me see if I'm going to get something now. And many of us are running around, we don't even have enough insurance to bury ourselves. I know I'm preaching. We don't even have enough insurance. And somebody, our family might have to stand on a corner with a sign. I'm preaching the best I can. Because y'all see the signs. My wife and I, we used to go round and round about insurance, life insurance. And we still go round and round. Because my wife believes that, you know, look, the dead bury the dead. No, they don't. No. No live folk bury dead people. Are y'all praying? When Jesus talked about that, that was a metaphor he was using. That was an illustration he was using. Are y'all praying with me? But y'all see who buried dead people. And I believe in heaven. And I believe I'm more valuable to her dead than I am alive. I know that. I see what I make every year. Come on, somebody. The tax man tells me what I make every year. And they don't have no comparison to what she'll get if I check up out of here tomorrow. Arrangements for family. Because you are not off the hook because you died and talking about them, but they gotta do it like I did. No, they don't. Your responsibility is to leave some money so rent can still be paid. So food will still be on the table. Are y'all praying with me? I wish I didn't have to preach this, but I'm preaching to most of us in here. You don't have enough insurance to bury yourself. How are you taking care of your family? You need to make arrangements for family. And for those of you who take care of that, God bless you. I ain't talking to you. Are y'all praying with me? Not only do you need to see them or look for them, you need to look out for them. Are y'all praying with me? Jesus found a way. And so many of us are so full of excuses why we can't take care of our business. I've been in prison. I don't have a job. Jesus was on the cross. What could he do? He figured out a way. Come on, somebody. We figure out everything else. Even if you have to ask somebody, don't you be so arrogant and proud that you can't ask somebody for some help to make arrangements for your family. I wish I had a witness in here. There are a lot of single parents in our community. I ain't gonna talk about our church. And there's a lot of single parents in our community. There are some single nobody. Yeah, you do. Because in order for her to be a woman, she needs to see a godly woman. And y'all already know where I'm about to go now. There are a lot of single mothers in the church and in our community. You need some help raising boys. Amen. I don't care how bad you are. I don't care how tough you are. You are not a man. And it takes a man to raise a man. Ask somebody for some help. There are some godly men who will be glad to be a surrogate father. If you ask them, ask somebody. I was home, I was visiting. And my niece was helping me out. Because my niece has two boys, beautiful boys. And she's raising them the best she can. But a father ain't what he ought to be. But I'm thankful for the father's father. Amen. Granddad. Amen. And granddad said, I'm going to step up and do what my son is not willing to do. Amen. And so he spends time with those boys. He works with them. And those boys are some well-mannered young men. I wish I had a witness in here.
Right.
Jesus died on Calvary's cross. for his family. He made us the beneficiary of his death. Y'all gonna get me in a minute. He died so that other people could live. He died so that other folks would have their needs met. He died so that the family of God could be in a better place than they were and then before they were in relationship. Jesus died so that you and I could be set free. I wonder, is there anybody in here who's made arrangements for their family, even in death, so that even though you die, you make a way for some other folks. Some other folks to go to school and to have their needs met and to have their bills paid on time. Ain't got to pack up out the house because you ain't there to provide a salary to pay the rent. Is there anybody in here willing to make arrangements so that they are beneficiaries when you die? But are many of us, we act like we ain't gonna never die. We live like we ain't gonna never die.
Yeah.
You're going to live forever. You're not. You're going to die. You and me. I'm going to die. You nigga, you can make arrangements so that there are beneficiaries from your death. That your children are left with a legacy of somebody who knew the Lord and loved the Lord and served the Lord. Somebody they can look at and model, be an example to. That your children have a legacy of being a part of the family of God. If you here by yourself and you left children in the bed at your house, shame on you. You need to make them a beneficiary of your relationship with God. Are y'all praying with me? Amen. Amen. Make arrangements. Not just monetary, but spiritual. You can't will your faith to anybody, but you sure can expose them to your faith. Like, why are you tripping? Asking an 8-year-old, do you want to go to church today? You don't know at 8, you don't know what you want. Some of us 28 don't know what we want. You don't know. Get your behind up, we're going to church. My wife said, you just cruel. You just old fashioned. You're hard. Well, that's how my mama was. Come on, somebody.